bright lights and promises, a pocket full of dreams. That's what they paid me to be.
Hello, Michael from Rich Hair Diaries. It is Wednesday, January 16th, 2013. I'm in Nova Scotia, Canada. And today it is the Rich Hair Diaries word pictures, not moving pictures. Now, it's taken me months to get through this. Ernest Hemingway, A Life Story by Carlos Baker. And I bought this book in, I think I had it listed here, yeah, February 75. So what is that? That's 38 years ago, isn't it? 85, 95, 2005. Yeah, 38 years ago. So when I was 23, I bought this book. And I figured out, I estimated yesterday that it has been packed up at least 14 times because I bought it. I know where I was living at home when I got this, when I bounced back at, between trips or whatever. And to the family. And then I've moved at least 14 times since then. I mean, I think when I was younger, I was moving every 6 months. This is what, you're young, you know, the word I think is peripatetic. You're all over the place here. You don't know what the future holds. Oh, you're gonna try to save rent here. You're gonna try to get a better place here. You're moving in with somebody here. You're moving out from somebody. This is what it's like quite often. You know, once you go out into the world and leave home for good, and this is what it was like. So, this book, it means that this book went from Nova Scotia to British Columbia when I moved there the first time, then back to Nova Scotia when I moved back to run a bookstore, and then back to British Columbia when I went there, and then stayed there for 28 years. And then back to Nova Scotia. And I finally got around to reading it because I had to read all of these. I'd read some before, but I had to read all of these a few years ago when I was working on a master's in humanities, which I never did write the thesis, so I don't have the master's, but I did do all the classes and I did quite well because I wanted to have to read a lot of classic literature and philosophy and history, you know, like, because I was really missing that in my education. I was missing my undergraduate degree that I took, sort of like having to read things and, you know, being taught things, so I enjoyed that. So some of these I'd read before, but I read A Farewell to Arms. This is going back about 5 or 6 years, probably. I don't think I dated these ones. I used to date my books when I got them. Oh, July 2003, so it's almost 10 years ago that I started reading these. So, time's flying, I'm telling you. Farewell to Arms. Finally got around to seeing the movie with Rock Hudson and Jennifer Jones last year. I bought a disc and I quite enjoyed it. Sun Also Rises. I read that in undergraduate university in the early 70s, and I read it again almost 10 years ago. Old Man and the Sea. And I read this, I don't know if it was high school or some other place, but you had to read it. So I read that again. This was new in our time, short stories, I believe. It was, it's been a while. These are nice covers though. I mean, the books look like they're not read, but they actually were, okay? And For Whom the Bell Tolls. This was his magnus opus, I would call it. And that was made into a movie with Ingrid Bergman and Gary Cooper. And I still have not seen that movie since the maybe 20 or 30 years ago. Look, see, I actually wrote some good papers on this stuff. If I can find my proper, I have about 6 computers and about three or four of them I'm not using. So I'll have to get them going someday so I can find my old papers, and I'll put them up on my blog for people if they want to take a look at them. Because I have lots of undergraduate and graduate papers that I wrote, and things that I've written about my family and things that I should actually have up there for people to see. And this one, I looked in my shelves until I found it. I remember buying it, and this I bought September 2003, so that's almost 10 years ago. On remainder, $7.99. And I don't even know what it was in Canada, but I'm sure it was $20 or $30. Michael Palin's Hemingway Adventure. So I haven't read this, but this is, he goes and follows in the footsteps of all the places that Hemingway went on his adventures. So, Michael Palin from Monty Python. And what's going to be great about this is when I sit down and I browse through this, I've read the entire biography now of Hemingway. 750 pages, so I'll be able to put those two together. Now, 715, and then the notes start, which I'm not reading. Sources and notes begin on page 715. Now, so that is this part here. It's another 200. The book ends at past page 950. So I'm not going to read the over 250 pages of references. You would have had to read them as you went along, which is backing up the events that are mentioned in the biography. This is how things used to be done. So that's, you know, not of interest to me, like I just read it as it goes, right? But this is written by an academic, and he's actually mentioned in the book. And what's funny is that he doesn't mention when he appears in the book. He doesn't say this author. He just calls himself Carlos Baker. I thought it was very odd. So maybe that was the way it was supposed to be when they were writing this. This came out in 68 or 69, 1969, I guess. So I stopped it when the narrative stopped. And I must say, it took me a long time because I was only reading it bits and pieces and lunchtime and things like that. And I'm going to take a hiatus from the web so I can get back to reading. I want to finish Game of Thrones 3 and 4. I want to definitely finish 3 before the show comes back at the end of March. But anyway, it was very satisfying to read a full-length biography again. I hadn't read one since I think I read the one about Truman Capote a couple of years ago, maybe. Oh dear, it looks like it's going to snow heavily today. I have to go to work in a couple of hours and take Ted to work. And it's about, I guess it's 1:30? No, it's just about 1 o'clock, so. Oh dear, I don't want a problem. And what else? So, Ernest Hemingway, I do recommend that you dip into some of his books. I did find For Whom the Bell Tolls quite good. It tells you a lot about the Spanish Civil War. But, I mean, he is an American, and he's over there thinking he's rescuing people, basically. So whether there's authenticity to For Whom the Bell Tolls, I actually can't tell because I don't have that experience of living in a dictatorship or under fascist regime, you know. And it's not the history in Canada, so it's hard for me to figure out if he was on the right of history or not. And this one, you know, it's considered, I think he won the Pulitzer Prize for it. It's considered a wonderful novel, but it really, to me, I think it's just a snore. But it is a good exercise in style. And it's about perseverance, obviously, and about how things just, everything stays the same, I think. This one is about the lost generation after the First World War in Paris and in the environs in Spain and going to the bullfights. And the hero in it actually, suffered a genital problem. Probably had his penis shot off in the war or something, so he can't make it with a woman anymore. And that's the crux of this book. So the sun might rise, but the rest of it isn't. So that's what this is about, is restless people. The damage of war and all of that sort of stuff. So, Farewell to Arms. What's nice about this book, and if you see the movie with Rock Hudson, is it's about a soldier, and he's certainly not a coward by any means, but then the futility of war finally gets to him, and he runs off with the nurse, and they go to try to have an idyllic life in the mountains, and I forget where they ended up, I guess it was in Italy. And this is the First World War, and the futility of trying to escape your destiny, basically. And then this one's short stories, some of the Nick Adams stories, I guess. So I want to tell you that I've been to Hemingway's house in Key West. I haven't been to Cuba. I guess that's the only place that I've been. Well, I've been to Malaga in Spain as well, and he's made several visits there. And I've certainly been to Chicago when he was there and things like that, but basically I've only been to one place that had his stamp on it, and that was in Key West. The place where he had all the cats, the six-toed cats. And I really enjoyed my touristy visit there one time in Key West when I was on a cruise, and that was its first stop. And that's 10 years ago, I think that was 2003. And I took some photographs. I don't know where they are now, of course. But I'll say that he was certainly more complex than I knew about. But then again, people always are. And if you're going to have a biography of this size, you know, either you're going to get the full story. It's really too much information in this book. But I went through four wives. It looked like three, four, or five kids. I can't even keep track. You know, they seem to be dropping out of all the wives, at least two of them. I was even more compelled to read this because I watched the HBO show a few months ago called Hemingway and Gellhorn. Gellhorn was Martha Gellhorn's third wife. And she's very, very accomplished journalist and war reporter and everything in her own right. So she was quite a piece of work for him because she just didn't basically put up with all his bullshit. So I enjoyed that, and then I had read that book that I showed you a few months ago called The Crook Factory, which is about Hemingway's World War II activities when he was living in Cuba and he was trying to hunt for submarines using his fishing boat and things like that. And it's all based on a true story, and it is all mentioned here several times in here, The Crook Factory. Is what they called their little counter-espionage operation. And so that's what brought me back to deciding to make the commitment to read this. So you could say I'm a Hemingway fan. I'm not an acolyte. I think they're worth reading. This style was fresh in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, but it doesn't seem so fresh now because he's had a lot of imitators. But I just wanted to share my experiences with my Hemingway items here. And he, you know, it's no big surprise. It's well known that he killed himself, I think, at age 60 or 61. I think he was 60, and so I'm older than Hemingway was when he killed himself. So he suffered a lot of depression. His father had committed suicide, and a lot of his descendants committed suicide, like including Mariel Hemingway's sister, Margot Hemingway, the model, and I think her father had killed himself as well. So the Hemingways have a real streak of melancholia, that's for sure. Anyway, I wanted to do a book commentary for a change, and it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and I'd love to hear from people who've read Hemingway or been to the Hemingway house. So Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and I'll see you around the tube.